I tell you what, if you haven't been horrified with Obamacare yet, you're going to be today. We have a horror story about what they're going to do to you, and you don't want to miss it.
Horror story.
Horror story.
It is scary. It's a little scary. Well, Obamacare is still unpopular with the public, and even though it was supposed to make the health care system better, critics say it's failing. Jennifer Wishon has the story from Washington.
It's supposed to create jobs, provide health insurance for all Americans who want it, and save money. Instead, the Affordable Care Act, for many Americans, has already become a source of heartburn.
This is legislation that was 2,500 pages long, now 20,000 pages of legislation.
That's 17,500 pages of new regulations written by bureaucrats, on top of an already complex law passed by Congress. After catching heat for several weeks, President Obama is working to promote the positives of the law he maintains will help those in need.
Affordable health care is not some privilege just for the few. It's a basic right that everybody should be able to enjoy.
His efforts came one day after the House voted for the 38th time to eliminate, cut funding, or scale back the law. Already, the mandate that businesses provide coverage for their workers has been put on hold because new regulations made it too difficult for companies to comply.
For example, there is the employer mandate, the requirement that businesses with 50 or more full-time equivalent employees provide health insurance or pay penalties. That was a 3.5-page provision that got turned into a 144-page regulation with 44 definitions.
One study predicts Obamacare will put more than 3 million jobs in jeopardy. Even union bosses who once supported the law are now calling on Congress to fix it. In a letter to Democrat leaders, they write, "The Affordable Care Act would shatter not only our hard-earned health benefits, but destroy the foundation of the 40-hour work week that is the backbone of the American middle class. We have a problem," they write. "You need to fix it."
This is going to be a big lose-lose-lose for a lot of union members, and I think that if there isn't a resolution in Congress, if they don't reopen the law, a lot of them are going to question why they're paying all these dues to leadership that doesn't really represent their interests.
President Obama maintains that Americans who like their insurance plan can keep it, but that's not turning out to be the case. According to a study of 11,000 plans on the individual market, less than 2% comply with Obamacare. That means 98% of plans must change, or the people using them must find new plans. It's true more Americans will have health insurance under Obamacare, but that will lead to greater demands on the health care system.
The government's own chief actuary says that about 15% of hospitals will close as a result of this because they're no longer viable.
Still, even after all 20,000 pages of regulations are implemented, not all Americans will be insured. CBO estimates by the year 2023, 30 million Americans still won't have insurance. And by that time, America will have spent nearly $2 trillion implementing the law.
We're spending a lot of money in helping relatively few people. In many ways, it probably would have been simpler and cheaper just to give everybody money to buy insurance.
Obamacare gives extraordinary discretion to the Secretary of Health. In fact, some 1,000 times, the law gives her power to create definitions and regulations. And that's why the number of pages in the law keeps on growing.
The law is so complex, even some Democrats worry it will be tough to implement. Some also fear it will become a political liability for them in next year's elections. Jennifer Wishon, CBN News, Washington.
20,000 pages. Do you understand it?
Well, no, I have not read it, 20,000 pages. I just feel bad for the businesses that, you know, they're being penalized.
Everybody's being penalized. It's going to be a huge hit across the board. You know, CBN is, the truth is, when you look at a company and you have employees and you want to provide health benefits, truth is, the company is essentially self-insured, but you run it through an insurance company and they do the paperwork. But they'll throw back to you if you have too many people sick, then and the costs go up, then they're going to charge you more money as an employer. So I tried to make sense of that thing some years ago, and it was tough just when it's simple. But 20,000 pages of regulations? How can anybody know whether they can comply with the thing? How can doctors know? How can hospitals know? How can businesses know? Nobody does.
Well, Nancy Pelosi said they had to pass it in order to read it.
But, I mean, it's crazy. Ladies and gentlemen, you let bureaucrats get hold of anything and they will ruin it. And if the bureaucrats happen to be lawyers, they'll ruin it twice as bad. It's just unbelievable. Well, the House says, we're not going to fund it. And they keep saying, we won't fund it. And they keep saying, we won't fund it. You can't have any appropriation of money unless it goes through the House of Representatives. But it looks like the president's ignoring all that. But this thing has got to be killed. Somebody take a bullet and shoot it in the head and get rid of it. Take it out and bury it and then go back. There's certain things that are needed. You have to have portability of your plan. You have to have some simplicity of it. You know, it has to go across state lines and so forth. And you can expand coverage so that people who've got chronic conditions get covered. They're not left out. But beyond that, what this is going to do, there's an incentive for healthy younger workers to get out of it because it's cheaper to pay the penalty than to pay the enormous costs of the new insurance. Mm-hmm. So the labor unions are saying, hey, it's hitting us in the pocketbook. And, well, we'll see. Well, in addition to the pocketbook issues that you'll suffer, cities across the country are facing huge problems. Why? Because they had employer federal or state or city employee unions. And these unions had enough power to get what they wanted, and they figured it was a big melon and a big gravy train to which there was no end. And so they thought, well, it's just money, and we can get our money, and they didn't care where the money came from. Well, one such city is Detroit, where they kept raising the cost of retirement, the benefits that workers got. And now the city of Detroit says, we can't pay it anymore. We're going bankrupt. But a judge said, well, according to Michigan law, you've got to get state approval if you're going to do that. And so now they're coming back and they're suing again or appealing the judge's ruling saying, we've got to go bankrupt. But can a municipality go bankrupt and what's the consequences? Lee Webb has that report.
Pat, the city of Detroit defending its right to file for bankruptcy in federal court today. Lawyers for the city are seeking to have a series of lawsuits put on hold so the Chapter 9 bankruptcy can go through. But former city employees say they're owed pensions, and they claim that filing for bankruptcy violates the state of Michigan's constitution. Ephraim Graham has that story.
It's a battle that will determine whether the city of Detroit is obligated to its past or if it can start fresh and have a chance at a future. At the heart of the issue, pensions. Detroit promised the benefits to thousands of retirees, but the money to pay up isn't there. Bill Frezza from the Competitive Enterprise Institute says pension reform is a necessity if Detroit is going to recover.
It's going to be painful for a lot of people. But continuing to kick the can and deny reality can only lead Detroit towards what we're seeing in Greece.
But city workers, retirees, and pensioners are suing. They claim filing for bankruptcy violates the state constitution, which guarantees pension benefits will be paid in full. Last week, a Michigan Circuit Court judge sided with the pensioners.
There's been a violation of the constitution. I don't think the constitution should be made to be Swiss cheese. Once we erode it with one hole, there will be others.
Now the federal court is weighing in. U.S. bankruptcy judge Stephen Rhodes will consider Detroit's request to put on hold all lawsuits filed against the city before it filed for bankruptcy. The legal question at the heart of Detroit's bankruptcy filing has never been answered in the nation's high courts. But this case could be crucial, considering how many other cities are heading in the same direction. Frezza says for many of those cities, it's already too late.
If you look at the dollars in the operating budget that are going to legacy costs in so many of these cities, there's no way to turn them around. And so they might be able to slow things down, but there's got to be a reckoning, and both municipal bondholders and pensioners have to take a haircut.
For now, all eyes are on Detroit as it's decided just how far the U.S. bankruptcy code goes and whether it trumps state law. Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
The American pastor imprisoned in Iran for his faith has now been held for more than 300 days. 33-year-old Saeed Abedini was finally given medical treatment Saturday after suffering for months from injuries inflicted by prison guards. He was taken to a private hospital where he was examined and given medication. Pastor Abedini was convicted and sentenced to 8 years in Iran's brutal Evin prison just because he's a Christian. He's been beaten, subjected to intense interrogation, and threatened with death. Abedini's wife, Nagma, is thankful for the prayers and support. The American Center for Law and Justice represent Abedini's wife and their two young children who live here in the U.S. American pastors could be charged in the future with hate speech for speaking out on their conviction about same-sex marriage. That's the warning from Texas Republican Senator Ted Cruz. Cruz spoke at a recent Pastors and Pews event in Iowa, and he told CBN's David Brody that pastors who support traditional marriage could face big problems down the road.
If you look at other nations that have gone down the road towards gay marriage, that's the next step of where it gets enforced, is it gets enforced against Christian pastors who decline to perform gay marriages, who speak out and preach biblical truths on marriage, and that has been defined elsewhere as hate speech, as inconsistent with the enlightened view of government. And I think there is no doubt that the advocates who are driving this effort in the United States want to see us end up in that same place.
And for all of David's exclusive political coverage, you can check out his blog, The Brody File. That's at cbnnews.com. Attorneys for a Christian couple that fled Germany to homeschool their children are taking their case now to the U.S. Supreme Court. CBN News has covered the story of the Romakis. They moved to Tennessee 5 years ago because they feared the German government might take their children from them. They would not comply with a law mandating that all German children attend school. They didn't like some of the lessons in schools there, like graphic sex education as well as witchcraft. A federal judge granted the family asylum here in the U.S., but then the Sixth Circuit Court of Appeals later ruled that they did not meet the criteria for asylum. You can find out more about this case on cbnnews.com. Well, New York City has a new plan to fight the battle of the bulge. Have doctors prescribe a menu of fresh fruits and vegetables to help obese patients. The New York Daily News reports the city will provide coupons to offset the cost of the produce. The program will encourage parents and their children to eat at least one more serving of fruits or vegetables per day. One mother says it's already been a success for her 11-year-old son. She says he used to be a McDonald's baby, but after switching to vegetables, he's lost 20 pounds. And you know, by golly, Pat, we do need the government to tell us how to eat right, don't we?
I tell you, that's score one for Michael Bloomberg. On his way out, he's got a victory. Mm. That's a fantastic idea, to give a coupon for people to eat fresh fruits and vegetables. That's smart. It's better than going after big gulps.
Yeah, another good way to get your vegetables is juicing. Yesterday, get this, I juiced broccoli, green apple, kale, ginger, and celery, and it was delicious.
Was it? You sure?
Yeah, and I had it like as a meal replacement.
You're not saying it just because you did it.
The green apple makes it really sweet.
Really?
Actually, green apple and broccoli, I love those two together. And I love pineapple and broccoli. Because you think broccoli would taste terrible juiced.
Yeah.
But it doesn't, as long as you put it with something sweet.
You are the poster child of a healthy living.
Trying.
I'm proud of you. That's great.
I've got to be honest. I mean, I love my ice cream, and I love all that stuff, too. But I like the good stuff, too. The thing is, you got to have balance, right? You got to have balance.
I'm a fan of chocolate, bitter. I mean, you know, dark chocolate. And 72% or better higher of cocoa, and it's good for you, good for your heart, and it satisfies whatever craving. If there is a craving, I don't got no craving for sweets anymore. I really,
really?
Don't. No, I don't crave. You crave because they set up, it's like booze, you know. it's the same reaction, you know. It's broccoli, like kale, green apple.
Don't forget the green apple.
All mashed together.
Just put it down in your juicer.
And out comes this green goo.
I'll bring you some. No, it's very like a juice.
And it tastes good.
It's fantastic.
Wow.
Yeah, you'll love it.
Speaking of New York, have you seen former Congressman Anthony Weiner? Boy, are they eating him up. he apparently, 1 year after that scandal of him sending scantily clad pictures of himself to girls, he did it again, 1 year later.
And his wife is on TV defending
him.
Oh,
please. Well, I mean.
What a story.
Maybe they'll do a TV series and they'll call it The Good Wife.
A federal judge is placing a key part of an Alabama abortion law on hold until next year. That law tightens restrictions on abortion providers, and opponents say it will force the closing of more than half of the state's abortion clinics. It was set to go into effect August 15th, but U.S. District Judge Myron Thompson issued an order delaying enforcement until March 24th of 2014. That gives the court time to move forward with a lawsuit filed by Planned Parenthood and the American Civil Liberties Union. Commissioners in Rowan County, North Carolina, cannot open their meetings with a prayer to Jesus Christ. A federal judge has stopped the prayers for now in response to a lawsuit by the ACLU. The suit filed on behalf of three county residents claims that opening a government meeting with the prayers of just one faith violates the Constitution. Rowan County commissioners are looking for legal advice before responding to that. You can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com.